Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Agricultural Innovation Center, or AIC, program webinar for applicants. Thank you very much for joining us today. I would now like to introduce and turn the presentation over to Sammy Zaror, the Director of Program Management Division in the Rural Business Cooperative Service. Sammy?
Thank you, and welcome all, and thank you for taking the time to participate in the webinar today. The Agriculture Innovation Center, also known as the AIC program, has been authorized nearly two decades ago. Limited funding, though, we've had little activity because of little funding over the years. However, we now have increased funding appropriated for the program. The program makes grants to centers to provide technical assistance to agriculture producers. This helps them develop and market value-added agriculture products using a variety of options. For example, the Agriculture Marketing Resource Center works with the Value Added Producer Grant Program, also known as VAPG. The AIC program provides funding to centers that can work with agriculture producers on getting their products to the market, while the VAPG program awards funds directly to agriculture producers for planning and working capital activities, while the Resource Center publishes information related to value-added agriculture. They also provide videos of successful VAPG projects. We understand that the program has many specific requirements that can seem complex, and we are working towards helping provide you clarity so you may have successful awards. This includes clarifying some of the requirements in the public notice. And we have prepared this webinar to further explain the program requirements to help you figure out if you would like to apply. I'll turn things over to Gail Thuner, who manages the program. Thanks again for joining us today. Gail?
Good morning, everyone. Hi, my name is Gail Thuner. Thank you so much for coming today. The first thing I want to tell you about is I am the current program manager for the AIC program. You can find my contact information at the end of the presentation in case you have follow-up questions about this process or the program in general. Honey Turner is also a contact for the program, and her information is at the end of the presentation too. I've got our agenda up on the screen now so you can see how we'll proceed today. First, I'll give you an overview of the program, including some of the background on how the program started. Once we've covered those basics, I'll talk about what the eligibility requirements are for the program and go through what you need for an application. Then I'll explain how we process applications and make awards. Finally, I'll open up the webinar for your questions. So the first thing we're going to do is talk about the program in general. I'm going to go through a little background on the program and then explain what the main purpose of the program is. The AIC program was first authorized in the 2002 Farm Bill. It was set up to provide grants to agriculture innovation centers that would work with agricultural producers to help them develop and market value-added agricultural products. We didn't have the resources to run the program back in 2002, but we did in 2003, so we made 10 awards for about $10 million. After 2003, though, the program lost its funding until 2018. By then, the program had been dormant for so long that we had some legal and policy questions to tackle. Once we resolved those questions, we opened the application period for the program in October of 2019. We selected three applicants for funding, and we learned a lot about the challenges of this program and the kinds of questions that our applicants have. So we did make a few adjustments to the language in our Federal Register notice to help answer those questions and provide some clarity on a few issues that came up last year. Hopefully this webinar will provide some useful information to help you decide if you want to apply for a grant during the current application period, which closes on September 27th. The purpose of the program is to award grant funds to centers that then provide technical assistance to agricultural producers who want to develop and market a value-added agricultural product. The way the funds can be used has caused some confusion, and we have had to make some adjustments. And I'll go through the use of funds more specifically later in the presentation. But for now, just remember that centers need to provide services directly to agricultural producers to help them develop and market a value-added agricultural product. The program also has some important thresholds to be aware of. There is a minimum of $400,000 on the awards, and the statute sets a maximum of $1 million. The grant award can cover up to two-thirds of project costs. Remember that project costs include both federal and matching funds, so what that threshold means is that the grant can pay for two-thirds of the project, and matching funds must cover the other third. We also set a two-year period of performance for new centers, because our experience back in 2003 was that centers had a big learning curve and a lot of hoops to jump through to get started on their projects. Now that we have a general idea of what the program does, let's talk about what the eligibility requirements are. So for eligible organizations, basically all types of organizations are eligible. The only restriction we have is that individuals cannot apply. So that means nonprofit organizations, for-profit or commercial organizations, institutions of higher education, state governments, local governments, and federally recognized Indian tribes are all eligible to apply. The AIC program does have a matching funds or cost-sharing requirement for one-third of the project's cost. And again, remember, as we talked about before, the project cost is the sum of the grant funds and the matching funds. So for example, if you want to request a $1 million grant award, you would need to provide at least $500,000 in matching funds. Those matching funds can come from a variety of sources, including the applicant's cash reserves and third parties. One important consideration when you are looking at using matching funds from a third party is how the funds can be used. For example, if you are planning to use a state grant as match, you need to make sure that that grant can be used for allowable purposes for the AIC program. Another consideration is making sure that if the funds are in-kind services from a third party, that you have a good method for valuing those services. The requirements for the center's governance are probably the most challenging for applicants to meet, so it's worth spending some time talking about them. The first thing is that the center needs to have independent governance. What does that mean exactly? Well, the center can be a subsidiary or some other kind of subordinate organization of the applicant organization, but the center needs to have a separate board of directors, control over personnel decisions, including hiring and firing employees and contractors, the ability to set policies and procedures, including personnel and procurement, the ability to develop and approve its budget, and to select their own board of directors after it's initially set up by the center. The second thing is that the center needs to have a board of directors with a certain composition. The program statute dictates which organizations must be represented on the board. The members must include representatives from the following organizations: the general agricultural organization with the most members in your state, the general agricultural organization with the second most members in your state, the State Department of Agriculture or a state legislator, and four agricultural commodity organizations. So for the first two representatives, how do you figure out who the top two general agricultural organizations are in your state? Well, the first one is most likely to be your state's Farm Bureau. After that, you'll have to do some research. The Farm Bureau may know, or you can check with your state Department of Agriculture or a land grant university that has a strong agricultural program. Another option is Google. That's often how we look things up here. One other big issue that we discovered last year is that some state departments of agriculture may think that it is a conflict of interest to have a representative on a center's board, So it is important to check that out before you get commitment from your State Department of Ag. State legislators may have a similar issue based on the committees or legislation that they are working on. One way to check to see if there is a conflict of interest is to have the state legislator speak with their council or ethics committee. Finally, you need to get four representatives from different commodity organizations that have representation in your state. These organizations must be representing agriculture commodities, not end products. Good types of organizations to look for are ones that represent producers or growers, and there are some state marketing boards that might work too. Another eligibility requirement that can be hard to meet, especially for organizations that are new to providing assistance to agricultural producers, is being able to show existing capability to provide services. Either the applicant organization must have the experience to provide those services, or there need to be at least two key personnel committed to the project that have that experience. And it is important to remember that the experience must be the same type of experience as what you are proposing in your application. So if you want to provide financial services and organizational services, either your organization or your key personnel must have at least 3 years of experience providing those types of services to agriculture producers. So now we'll talk about support of the agricultural community. You'll need to have at least 3 support letters from agricultural organizations. These organizations must have a primary mission to support agriculture. They need to be based in the state or region that the project will serve, and they need to serve the same group of producers that are targeted by the proposed project. What we found last year is that there can be some confusion about this support, and we saw letters coming in from general economic development organizations. So it is important that you consider the organizations that are going to provide this support. It should be clear either from the name of the organization or in the body of the letter that the organization supports agriculture. There should also be enough information in the letter that we can figure out where the organization is based and what kind of producers they work with. For example, it wouldn't make sense for you to get support from an organization that works with hemp producers if you aren't planning on doing any work with hemp producers. Instead, you would want support from organizations that have some kind of connection to your project. You also need to make sure that your project has a clear focus on helping agricultural producers develop and market value-added agricultural products. So that means being clear in your application and providing descriptions of services that use words like agricultural producers and value-added. A problem that several applicants had last year is that they were too general in their descriptions of their services. So they were describing general business development services, but didn't indicate any focus on value added. Or they weren't clear that they would be working with ag producers. You need to remember that while general services can be very helpful, an Ag Innovation Center's job is to focus specifically on working with ag producers to develop and market value added agricultural products. So all the services that are provided need to be provided with that goal in mind, even if it could turn out that a producer opts not to market a product after receiving the center's service. So now I want to talk about use of funds. And there has been a little bit of a change from last year, so I want to make sure we go through this in detail. Last year, we didn't realize that we had an additional restriction on our use of funds for this program. So it wasn't highlighted in our Federal Register notice. This year, though, we want to make sure it is clear. What happened is that the 2018 Farm Bill included some language that restricts the AIC program from duplicating any uses of funds from LAMP programs. LAMP stands for Local Agricultural Marketing Programs. These programs include a couple that are run by the Agricultural Marketing Service, the Farmers Market Promotion Program, and Local Foods Promotion Program, as well as our own value-added producer grant program that you heard Sammy talk about earlier in the presentation. The AMS programs focus on joint marketing efforts like farmers markets, CSAs, and food hubs, while the value-added program focuses on planning and working capital grants for marketing value-added products. So that means a lot of services that centers provide cannot be provided to joint marketing efforts because that would duplicate these programs. Centers also can't do feasibility studies, business plans, and marketing plans, with one exception, and I'll talk about that on the next slide. So, centers can do the following services that are listed on the slide here. They can provide financial advisory services, although not to joint marketing efforts. They can provide process development services, organizational assistance, again, not to joint marketing efforts, outreach assistance to distribution systems, processing facilities, and commercial kitchens, rather to connect producers to those entities. And they can do product development with the exception of recipe development. The funds can be used to establish and operate the center. And the centers can also use the funds to make mini grants of $5,000 or less. One thing I want to highlight about the mini grants is that they need to be for the same types of services that the center would provide, and the matching funds requirement carries through. So if a center made a $5,000 grant to an ag producer, they would need to make sure that the producer was providing at least $2,500 in match. And the center would also need to go through the same kind of process that a federal agency would to make awards and to monitor the awards. So that can be a lot of work. So it's something to keep in mind if you're thinking about exploring that as a service for your center. Now I want to talk about the exception that I mentioned during the last slide. So while centers can't use grant funds to provide business and market development services or outreach services to joint marketing efforts, they can use their matching funds to do those things. So if you really want to provide those types of services, you can, as long as you find a way in your budget to be able to link those services exclusively to matching funds. Now that we've talked about the things that you can do with grant funds, I want to go through some of the things that you can't do. On this slide, I've chosen a handful of things that I think are most relevant that we tend to get the most questions about and that tend to cause the most problems. I do want to encourage you all, though, to take a look at the Federal Register notice and make sure you read the full section on restricted uses of funds to make sure that you know everything. But in particular, I wanted to point out that we can't use the grant funds to do construction, buy equipment, purchase or lease vehicles, conduct lobbying. The funds cannot be used for production expenses or processing expenses. And that's something that caused some confusion last year. So I want to make sure that you see that. Also, the funds cannot be used to purchase real property, to engage in research and development, or to engage in anything that could appear to be a conflict of interest. And then there are a few other restrictions that I wanted to remind you about. As I mentioned earlier, we do have a minimum and maximum award amount. So you need to make sure that your request falls within that. This year, the minimum amount is $400,000. The maximum amount is $1 million. Your center does need to propose providing assistance to more than one producer. We really are looking for centers that have the capability to provide a variety of services to a variety of producers rather than work with a single producer. The center can't earn revenue from processing or selling the product that is developed and marketed. The centers exist for the benefit of the agricultural producers rather than for their own benefit. But you can charge fees for services. So I don't want you to think that you can't earn revenue at all. It's just from the processing or selling of the product. And then finally, if your budget includes more than 10% of the cost as unallowable, then we would consider your application ineligible. So we try and give you a little bit of room in your budget to make a mistake. But it still is really important to make sure that you are aware of the things that you can and can't do with grant funds. So now that I've covered some of the bigger eligibility requirements, I want to run through a few of the other requirements on this slide. So you can apply for a maximum of 2 years for your period of performance. And period of performance means the time that your project is active. And I really recommend that you take the full 2 years in your proposal. We have found that centers need time to get up and running and start promoting their services. If you've had other federal awards, we will check to make sure you have satisfactory performance on those awards, which means things like submitting reports on time, performing according to the approved scope of work, and using funds for allowable purposes. We will also assess your financial capability by looking at your current ratio and cash on hand. And this probably seems a little bit simple, but your application needs to be complete. If you are missing something, we don't have the ability to come back to you and ask for it. Another thing to remember is that you can't duplicate services that you are currently providing. So one way to think about that is that you should either plan to provide new services to existing customers or existing services to new customers. And new customers can be just a different type of producer that you're targeting, just new producers in the same kind of field that you've been working in, or you could be targeting a different geographic area. Those are all ways to make sure that you're not duplicating what you're currently doing. Your organization is limited to submitting only one application. And finally, if you are expecting to contract with another center that you know is applying for this program, you need to limit your contract to 10% or less of your total budget. And that restriction exists solely to make sure that we can make sure that our awards are going to a variety of different centers and providing as much geographic distribution as possible. All right, so now that we have gone through the eligibility requirements, it's time to talk about what you need for your application. It's important to remember that the information in your application accomplishes two things. First, it gives us the information we need to assess your eligibility. Second, it gives us the information we need to assess the merit of your application relative to what other applications are proposing to do based on the evaluation or scoring criteria that we've set up. So the first thing is to know where you can find the application requirements. And you need to have a copy of the Federal Register notice that we published on June 28, 2021. You can find a copy of this notice in three places. It is published on the Federal Register website, and I'm going to actually take a minute here to show you how you can find it. So if you are in your internet browser here, we're going to go to the Federal Register. And the Federal Register is just federalregister.gov. And then we can do a search here. I don't know if you can see this up under search documents in the top right corner of your screen. You can search in a bunch of different ways, but I think if you just do Agriculture Innovation Center and try that, we should be able to get our notice to pop up right here. So you'll see it's this item here. And so now you're going to get a summary here, and then there'll be a printed PDF version that you can pull up and save. And I'm gonna actually show you kind of what that looks like. So it'll look like this when you pull it up. And so it's 10 pages long, and this goes through a lot of the eligibility information and the application information that we just talked about. So the second place you can find it is on our program website. And our program website, the link is in the Federal Register notice. You can just do another Google search and get it to come up, and I'll show you here. If you scroll down the page just a little bit, there's this blue button that says Federal Register on the page. You can click on that, and that will take you to the Federal Register notice that way. And then the final place that you can get it is on grants.gov. And the way to find grants, the announcement in grants.gov, I usually just use the CFDA number, which is 10.377. You just type that into the search box. And I'm going to close this out. So you can see here there's an opportunity number, RBCS-AIC-2021. That is going to give you the information, you'll see under related documents that the full, it's under this full announcement here, and here's your notice from Federal Register. So that's another way to get at it. I also want to highlight that we have a checklist and a template, and you can see the checklist and the template here on grants.gov under the related documents. I really encourage you to take a look. These documents were developed to help you put together a complete application so that you don't miss anything. And so I will kind of go through these two documents in a little bit more detail as we go through the presentation. So that's where we are there. So that's how you can find the requirements. So now let's talk about what the requirements are. So I think what we'll do first here is just go over this information on the slide. The SF-424 is a form, the standard form, and you probably use it if you've ever applied for any kind of federal assistance, and you'll need it for the AIC program as well. And then the SF-424A, that's a budget form, and you probably use that too. So those are pretty standard, and they're part of the grants.gov package. So let's see if we can go back to here. So if you look at your package, and I think if we click under preview, right? So here you'll see links to those two forms, and you'll be required to fill those out as part of your grants.gov submission. Then we have a certification on federal judgments and a certification on lobbying. Both of those actually are included in the template that we have. And I'll show you a little bit about the template here. So it will link a little bit. And if you scroll down, you'll see here Appendix C and Appendix D. That's the certification language. Even if you choose not to use the template, you can copy and paste the language from the template for your application. Finally, you need to submit your audit. This is one that caused some problems last year because some organizations that apply, they're big organizations, sometimes are public universities or state governments, and so the audits are publicly available. And applicants would include a link instead of the actual audit because the audit was a large file size. So that seems like a logical thing to do, but then what would end up happening is sometimes the links wouldn't work, or the website would be down for maintenance, or maybe the audit had just been taken down for some reason. So it's important to submit your actual audit, even if it's a large file size, because if we can't access your audit when we go to do our eligibility assessment, we won't be able to continue processing your application. So it is something that we really do need to have. Another thing that caused some confusion last year is applicant eligibility. There are some instructions in the notice that go through what you need to provide based on your organization type. And so usually we ask for a single document or legal citation. And even if you are Harvard University, please provide the information. We need it to show that you are a legal entity that is eligible to receive assistance through the program. So we do use it. We're not just asking it for paperwork reasons. We do need to have it. So please make sure that you submit it. The next thing that we require is a verification of matching funds. This is another one that can cause some people trouble. And again, I would highly recommend that you use the template, or at least the form from the template. And let's go through here and I'll kind of show you where that is. So here in Appendix G, we have a template for verifying your matching funds. So this is where you list all of your sources and the amounts and what you plan to use the money for. If you are having funds that are donated by a third party, you need to include a separate letter from each third party donating funds that is signed by the authorized representative of the organization and that identifies the amount, the use of funds, and the time period of availability. So you'll attach those as separate documents. It's really important that we do verify that matching funds requirement. Another thing is that you've got to tell us about the governance of your center. And so this is where you explain how your center has independent governance and how the decision-making processes are expected to work. So tell us about your personnel policies and your procurement procedures in this section. And I do want to kind of just give you a word of caution. If you say that your board of directors is advisory, you're not going to be eligible for the program. Advisory boards are not considered independent. So if you are thinking or you currently have an advisory board, think about how you could expand their role and make that board really be more independent for the center. You've also got to provide information about your board of directors. You probably remember from the eligibility slide that we talked about that the board of directors has some pretty specific requirements. And this is where you're going to tell us about that board. So you need to identify the name of the person who's going to be representing the organization on your board of directors. And then you need to provide a written commitment from that person, not the organization, that person who's going to be the representative. You'll also need to tell us about your existing capability. This is when, back, if you remember, when we talked about in the eligibility section, when you tell us what your experience is providing those services and try to demonstrate that you or your key personnel have at least 3 years. You're going to include 3 letters of support from agricultural organizations, and you're going to describe coordination and alliances. This is one that really confuses some people and they had a little trouble with it. So let's take a minute to talk about it in more detail. This is where you tell us all of the other organizations that you plan to work with. Despite the intent for an Agriculture Innovation Center to provide a fairly comprehensive suite of services, there are still things that the center is either not going to have a skill set to do, or it's in, it's kind of in the project's best interest to have an alliance or coordinate with another organization. So this is where you're going to tell us about those partner organizations or the other organizations that you may refer producers to for additional services. They may be organizations that help you promote your center services or that may refer producers to you. And so this is the section where you explain how that coordination is going to work and how your alliances are set up. You don't necessarily have to have every single thing figured out, but you should provide a lot of specific detail. All right, so now we're kind of getting into what I think of as the meat of the proposal. The items on this slide, the title page, table of contents, executive summary, goals, work plan, budget justification, and scoring criteria, this is what the peer review panel will see when they evaluate your application for merit, although we do use some of this information for eligibility too. And let me just show you kind of how this will look on the template. So we're going to scroll back up here to the beginning. You can see we have a title page here, and basically you're just clicking each field to enter the information that is appropriate for your application. If you use the template, the table of contents is automatically set up for you and will repopulate the pages, the page numbers, I think, if you do a right click and update table here. So that will update pages after you have filled in your information. And then there's a little page here for entering your executive summary where you're going to describe your project, your tasks, and anything else that gives a general overview of your project. For your goals, one of the things we've done with this template that's a change from what we did last year is to provide a little bit more detail in the template to help you target the information you provide. Because when you look at the requirements in the Federal Register Notice, sometimes it can seem a little bit overwhelming, and sometimes you may kind of skip over some words or miss something because a lot of the requirements have more than one component. So we try to break some of that stuff out in the template for you so that you can make sure you provide the information. So you're going to provide a listing of your producer services. You're going to identify at least one goal here. And if you have others, you can put those in. We've got a section for the scoring criteria here. And one thing you'll notice about the template is that the information is in a different order than it is in the Federal Register notice. And that's because Federal Register notices sort of have an expected order for the information and the requirements. So we kind of stick to that. But when it comes to putting together an application, there's often a better way to group information to make it easier for us to process and hopefully easier for you to kind of put like information with like. So the template is going to have things in a little different order. And to help you with that, our checklist has each requirement listed on the left column here. And then this middle column has the section or the place in the notice, the Federal Register notice, where you can find it. And then it has the section in the template. So you can make sure that you're reading the information in the notice that you need to read to understand the requirement and that you know where the information goes in the template. And there's also some notes here just for, you know, sometimes just to kind of answer frequently asked questions we've had about it or just to remind you of something that people often forget. So definitely this checklist is your friend and it's good to keep using it. So anyway, we've got these scoring criteria where even the scoring criteria have been broken down for you a little bit where it's appropriate to help you make sure that you get in all the components for each criteria. And we've set up charts for you to use to really help group the information and also hopefully helps you keep things brief. So you don't necessarily have to provide pages and pages of explanation. You can just quickly fill out the table and obviously you can delete any rows that you don't need. And this really helps our reviewers a lot when they go to take a look at your application. And then one thing is the work plan is kind of an eligibility requirement. And it's a scoring criteria. So we try to simplify that for you. You only have to put it in one place, and we recommend that you put it in with a scoring criteria. And here's where you're going to put in an overview with a narrative describing how things are going to work. And then you're going to kind of break things down for us so we can see what your description of a task is, the objective of your task, the potential outcomes of the task, and how the task connects to your goals. And that's an important part of scoring. So again, we've set this up for you to have several tasks listed in here. If you don't need some of these tasks because you've only got a couple, you know, you can just delete the things that you don't need. And then we have this work plan chart, which kind of helps summarize everything very quickly for this part of the evaluation process. So you're obviously welcome to submit your work plan in any format that you choose, as long as you meet the requirements. This is just a suggestion to help our reviewers make sure they can find information quickly and make sure they don't miss anything in your application. And so we do encourage you to use it, but if you prefer to present the information in another way, you certainly can do that. Another thing that I want to remind you about is the budget justification. And here there is a spreadsheet, basically, that just sorts things by category of expense and gives us the award and matching amount that you're looking at spending and also gives you a place to put in program income if you need it. And then there's a narrative below that spreadsheet where you give us a brief description about each section so that we can see what's in those categories. And this is especially important for our reviewers because they like to see how your expenses relate to your proposed tasks. So it's really important that you fill in this narrative, and we've tried to give you some clues here on the information that you need to include. And so you'll see that goes on for a few pages. We have qualifications of key personnel. And you don't need to submit resumes with your application. Instead, you're going to tell us the information that is relevant to your application. So skills and ability, years of experience, tell us about the number of times that different types of assistance was provided, what the outcome was, and the total hours contributed to the project, as well as whether the employer during the project was the center or whether they were a contractor. And so hopefully this makes it So you can just quickly fill out the information for your key personnel and make sure that you provide the same information for everyone that is complete for us to review. And again, if you don't have all these key personnel listed or signed up for your project, you can just delete that. We have local support, where you're going to be providing some letters of support. We ask that to kind of help you figure out what support you need. We've identified the types of organizations that we're looking for here. So all you need to do is type in the name and make sure you attach the letter of support. And then you'll need to do a brief description of how the support includes recognition of rural values that balances employment opportunities with environmental stewardship and other rural amenities. Then one of the criteria is future support. So this is where you come up with a specific plan for obtaining future funding for the center. And then we've got a chart here that you can use to enter how you're going to have diverse funding sources for your center. And then there's a place for describing how the in-house capacity for providing technical assistance will be improved. Now we are in the appendix part of the template, and a lot of this stuff we've already gone through before, but I just kind of wanted to give you a feel for how that looks. So I kind of jumped ahead on my presentation here because I got into my template, but hopefully that made sense to you. So now we're going to talk about application processing. And what that means is what we do with your application after we've received it. So when you submit your application, it will automatically, you'll have to apply through grants.gov. That's the only option that exists. And the system is going to issue an automated acknowledgement to you. And that lets you know that the grants.gov system has your application. The next step is that the system makes that application available to us at the agency, and we need to retrieve it from the system manually. And so after we have retrieved it and checked to make sure we can open the files and things like that, we will issue an email acknowledgement to you based on the contact information that you provided in your application. So we're going to acknowledge receipt separately from grants.gov. And it's going to take us a little time to issue that acknowledgement. Usually within about 2 weeks of the deadline, we'll have all those acknowledgements out. You're certainly welcome to send an email to check, but usually it just takes us a little time to get through all the applications. One thing I did want to mention before I move on, I guess, is that if you are having trouble submitting your application in grants.gov, you need to actually contact grants.gov customer support. We don't have any control over the system, and we can't see anything that you've done. The only time we can see anything in the system is after you've submitted your application and the system has sort of acknowledged it. At that point, it gets pushed to the agency level. So we're not going to be able to do much to help you if you're having a technical difficulty submitting your application. So I definitely recommend making sure that your authorized user or representative is set up well in advance of when you plan to submit your application. I recommend that you get your workspace set up, that you check to make sure you can open all of the documents, and that you just kind of have an understanding of how the system works. Do that at least a month, if you can, before the deadline, which is September 27th. That way you have time to ask questions. So one thing that, I did want to mention too, make sure your SAM registration is up to date. I know there have been some issues with that in the past, so definitely check on that. If your SAM registration is not up to date, grants.gov will probably reject your application when you try to submit it. After we have retrieved your application from grants.gov, we've issued an acknowledgement to you, then we're going to put your application into the eligibility review process. And that means we start looking at it for all those things that we talked about at the beginning of the presentation. We'll look at your organization type, we're going to look at your audit to evaluate financial capability. We're going to look to see if you have the support that you need, that your board of directors meets the requirement, all those things. And so once we have looked at your application for eligibility, we are going to either decide it's eligible or it's not eligible. If it's not eligible, that's stops the process for your application at that point. Only eligible applications will go on to be scored. And that's where we look at the merit of the application based on the scoring criteria that we just talked about in the template. And then we're going to have our reviewers take a look at the application. They're going to be focusing, of course, on the scoring criteria themselves, making sure they understand the budget, the work plan. They're going to look at your key personnel and all those different things. And they'll meet and discuss all the applications and come up with a ranking. And then once we have that ranking, the agency will select applications for funding. And we will notify the applicants that have had their applications selected for funding in writing. And we will also notify unsuccessful applicants. So the timing of this depends a little bit on the resources that we have. And so sometimes it can take a little bit longer than we would like, which it did last year. So I just encourage everyone to have some patience there. When we send out our notifications, if you're selected for an award, you'll get a specific set of information. Oh, and look, I'm going to talk about that in the next slide here. So we're going to email what's called a letter of conditions. And the letter of conditions tells you all of the conditions that you need to meet before we can finalize or approve an award to your organization. So it's super important to pay attention to those. Mostly, they are, you know, forms that you need to sign about federal requirements like a drug-free workplace or some pass-through requirements and things like that. They may also be things like requesting resumes for your key personnel. We may request your, if you have a NICRA or a negotiated indirect cost rate agreement with the federal government, we'll request that to verify the indirect cost rate on your application and make sure that's being charged correctly. We may have some minor questions about your work plan or your budget, and we'll ask you to clarify those. So you'll need to meet the conditions of the award, usually within 60 days of when we issue it, but that can be negotiable a little bit to the extent that you may have maybe more of a significant issue that comes up or something like that. Once you've met the conditions of the award, then we go ahead and put together a grant agreement and put that through our process. And then we approve the award essentially, and you can start your project. So the one thing I did want to mention too, if you didn't get selected for funding, we also share that information with you and we tell you why. So if you missed an eligibility requirement or two, we'll explain those requirements and identify that they were missing. And if you were, if your application was scored because it was eligible, but it just didn't score high enough to be funded, we'll also explain that to you. And along with that information, you will get something called a dispute resolution alternative. And usually with our program, that would be, you can request an administrative review, which is just sort of an informal conversation with us where we double check all of our work and go through it with you and you can ask any questions that you have. And then we also have a formal appeal process where you would present your case to a judge and explain why you think the agency made a mistake. So that option is there too, if you feel like we have made a mistake. So I think I've kind of quickly gone through this information. And now what I'd like to do is kind of turn things over to a question and answer period. I'm gonna have Taylor read the questions that have come in, if any, and we'll start with anything that's been submitted already and I'll try to answer any questions if I can live today, but there may be some that come up that I'm not going to be able to answer right away because I need to research or check into something. And so my understanding is we will be sending out an actual document to anybody who's registered so they can see those questions and answers and have them for future reference. So with that, I think I'm going to turn things over to Taylor to take a look at the questions.
Thank you so much, Gail, and thank you for that great, informative, and robust presentation. We do have several questions that came through, and I'll just start at the top and go down.
Okay.
The first question is, the instructions reference producers. Are producers defined as those growing crops or livestock, or can producers be defined as value-add food entrepreneurs who buy their ingredients from local farmers?
That's a great question. So we define agricultural producers as the producers, the person who actually has responsibility for the day-to-day production or growing of the livestock or crop. So if you buy the raw commodity like beans or tomatoes from a producer and then make tomato sauce or spaghetti sauce or some other kind of food product, you would not qualify as an agricultural producer. The program is really meant to target the actual producer of the raw commodity.
Thank you. And moving on to the next, how can a company that has the ability to open up overseas markets to local farmers benefit from the program?
Okay. So this program is really intended to work with agricultural producers. So the centers can only provide their services directly to ag producers. So that said, we understand that there are other players in the process to take a product from the field to the end user, the consumer. What centers can do is to provide connections to the producers and would be distributors, can be for overseas markets, and other kinds of sort of middlemen in that play a role in taking the product from the farm to the market. But those companies would not be able to get direct assistance from the center. Instead, it would be kind of like a matchmaking service that the center would provide between the producers and these other companies that could help distribute their product.
Thank you. And the next is, can you confirm that it is a 1/3 matching funds requirement? The examples given were 50% matching funds, not 1/3.
Okay, so that's a great question. I'm really glad you asked it because now I can address one of the things that has confused people. The way we calculate the matching requirement is based on the total project cost, not the grant amount that you requested. So if you request $1 million, then that is the grant or the federal portion of your project. The matching funds contribute the remaining part of that project. And so what we mean when we say 1/3 match is a 1/3 match of the total project cost, not the grant amount. So I hope that makes sense. So so what we mean then is if your total project cost is $1.5 million, 2/3 of that would be the federal funds of the grant of $1 million, and 1/3 of that would be $500,000. So it often looks like the match is 50% of the grant request, but what we're really looking at is starting with the total project cost, not the grant amount requested. And if anybody needs any more clarification on that, you know, definitely feel free to pop me an email and we can run through your budget to make sure that it's clear.
Right. Great. Thank you. Moving on. Is there a requirement on how much of the matching funds must be cash?
No, there is no requirement on how much of the matching funds must be cash. Do remember, though, that the only type of in-kind contribution is from third parties. And I will take this opportunity to address something else that has caused confusion for applicants in the past. And that, I think particularly I've seen this with universities. Universities who are contributing staff time to the project often consider that to be an in-kind match. In reality, we consider that to be a cash match because the university is still paying those staff from its budget and it's contributing that staff time to the project. So that would be considered a cash match. In-kind would really be if you had a contractor or a consultant, some other kind of expert, who wanted to donate part or all of their time to providing services. So that means they wouldn't get paid at all. or they would only get paid maybe 50% of their regular rate, and the rest would be donated. And there is no requirement on how much cash or how much in kind needs to be part of the budget.
Thank you. And the next couple questions are related, so I'm going to put those together. Can funds be used to establish or develop a center? And can you explain establishing and operating the center? Does that include rent and overhead?
Yeah, so that's a great question. Yes, funds can be used to establish and operate a center. And so what we mean by that is, depending on how your center, of course, is going to be set up, you're going to have an assortment of costs. In particular, you're going to have to get your board of directors meeting and approving procedures and policies and reviewing the budget to make sure everything is clear, and there may be some fine tuning. So, members of boards of directors often get a stipend, or they may get a travel cost reimbursement, that kind of thing. So those would be kinds of costs that you'd use. You may need to go out and find additional key personnel. So there would be personnel search costs as you try and find people to fill all the positions that you have. So those kinds of costs would be allowable. Let's see, in terms of operating a center, yes, things like rent for a facility, not just for your office space, but also if you are hosting meetings or training sessions for your producers, that kind of facility rental would be allowable. Also, your staff may have travel that they need to do, because they may, instead of having producers come to the center, the staff may go to the producers. And so in that case, those travel costs would be allowable. And of course, the cost of your staff and contractors will probably make up the largest component of the budget. So those are all things that we would consider to be part of establishing and operating a center. The one big thing to be aware of, if you don't have experience with federal awards already, to think about what direct costs and indirect costs you will charge to the award. And that's a pretty detailed conversation, so I definitely recommend getting in touch with me if you want to go through that. But in short, certain types of costs are generally considered appropriate to charge directly to an award, because you can directly link the work or the expense to the project. Other times, particularly if you have a lot of different things going on, so maybe the Agricultural Innovation Center is just one part of the work that you do, you may have clerical staff or other administrative support that supports the center as well as other activities. And in that case, you may look at charging an indirect cost rate. And if you already have one that's approved with the federal government, that's the one you use. So if you're from a university or a large nonprofit, you probably already have one. So you should check with your financial people to find out what that is when you're putting together your proposal. If you don't have one, there are a couple of options if you want to use an indirect cost rate because you think you need it. But you can also charge all costs direct to the grant if you don't already have an approved agreement with the federal government. So again, that's a pretty complex subject. So if you do have questions about that, I do encourage you to contact me.
Great, thank you. And the next is, what if we don't have an audit because we are a new center?
Yeah, so that's a really great question. If you don't have an audit, you are not eligible for the program at this time. You do need at least one audited financial statement in order to apply.
Thank you, Gail. The next is, can we add tasks in the work plan, or is six the maximum?
You can definitely add tasks. Usually we don't see more than six, but it definitely depends on how you like to break things down. So for example, some centers will consider each service that they offer to be a separate task. And so they may offer 10 different services, and then they would like to set those up as 10 different tasks in their work plan. That's totally fine. Just copy and paste if you want to use the template, or just do your own format if you prefer not to use the template. So definitely you can have more than six.
Thank you. The next is there a limit on indirect costs?
There is no limit on indirect costs. If you have a negotiated indirect cost rate agreement or NICRA with the federal government that is current, that's what we will use. So if it's 82% of salaries and wages, that's the rate and the base that we will use for your award.
All right, and the next question, do you have a target date for notifying final recipients? What's a good planning start date for the project?
Okay, that's a great question. I think in our notice, I might have to double check that, but I'm pretty sure we were thinking the end of February as kind of a target date, but definitely that could get pushed out a little if we get a lot of applications or something like that. So I would say, when you think about when your project would start, don't just think about you'll start your project immediately the day we tell you that you're selected for funding, because you will need some time to meet the conditions of the award and you'll probably need some time just to get things set up. So if I were planning, I might plan for June, July, August, maybe as a potential start date. You definitely, we're not going to pressure you to start immediately after we tell you you've been selected for funding. We'll definitely give you time. Even after you've met the conditions of the award, you don't need to start that day. You can take, you know, another month or 2 months or 3 months, and you'll want to consider who your target producers are, when you think they'll be likely to want to use the services of your center. So you may also consider, you know, not starting your center right in the middle of harvest season for the type of producers that you want to assist. You might consider waiting till the fall or something like that. So definitely there can be a lot of things to think about. And if you have any questions, you know, certainly you're welcome to get in touch, but I probably wouldn't set a start date much before June 1st of 2022.
Thank you. Next question. Can the one-third match go towards construction of a facility to house the program?
No, construction costs are not allowable. The only, typically speaking, when you're looking at a program, matching funds and grant funds should be used for the same types of allowable purposes. With the AIC program, because we have a very special restriction on use of funds that kind of put an extra burden on our centers to provide comprehensive services, we have made the decision to allow matching funds to be used for some of those services that a center would normally provide, like the feasibility studies, business plans, marketing plans, and doing some work with joint marketing efforts. However, when it comes to true funding restrictions, which you'll see in the notice, like construction, purchasing vehicles, research and development, all that kind of stuff, those are sort of hard restrictions. And so your match cannot be used for any of those things.
Thank you. The next question, can the one-third matching requirement be provided entirely through in-kind contributions?
Yes, the matching funds requirement can be provided entirely through in-kind contributions.
Great, thank you. The next is, will a recording of this presentation be sent to attendees after?
Taylor, you probably, Taylor, you probably know the answer better than I do. I think the answer is yes, right?
Yes, it will take some time to ensure that it is properly captioned. It will also be posted to the program website. But yes, once the link is available, and again, that may be 7 to 10 business days, we will email that out to all attendees. All right, and the next question, can you confirm that we can use indirect costs towards a match?
Oh, okay. So this is kind of a more sophisticated question. And this has to do with unrecovered indirect costs. So this typically would happen if you have an approved rate and you decide you'd like to charge less of that rate to this award and charge the difference between what you were approved to get and what you actually charged as match. And that's called unrecovered indirect costs. So that is only available to organizations that have a federally approved rate. If you don't have a rate, you can't do that. If you do have a rate, I believe our policy has always been that you can use the unrecovered indirect costs as matching funds. But definitely, if you decide that you'd like to do that, I do encourage you to get in touch with me, because there are some other considerations if you do that. One of those considerations is that the next time you go through your indirect cost rate approval or negotiation process with the federal government, you could lose, or they might reduce the rate that you're approved for. So it's important to think through that before you do it. So definitely, it is an option that's available, but I definitely encourage you to get in touch.
Thank you, Gail. The next question, is there a document that specifically outlines the independent governance requirements?
Oh, okay. So I think the best place to go to that is in the Federal Register. I'm just going to do some moving around on my screen here. So there's not a separate document, but the best place to see it is in the Federal Register here. I'll blow this up so that maybe we can all see it. So it's under this other eligibility requirements, independent governance. And so this is where we sort of are specific about what we consider a center, when we consider a center has independent governance. And we've given you some benchmarks here. So it has control over personnel, including hiring and firing employees and contractors, that it can set policies and procedures like personnel and procurement standards, that it can develop and approve its budget and select its own board of directors. And these last two, on developing and approving the budget and selecting the board of directors, can sometimes create a little confusion, because of course the applicant has to come up with a budget and has to find representatives for the board of directors before it can apply. So those things are already set to a certain degree when the center starts operating under the grant award. So what we would be looking for in that case is that the board of directors has approval over changes in the budget, and it can propose those kinds of changes to the agency. One thing to remember is that federal recipients have some control over their budget without needing prior approval from federal agencies, but there are some times when the federal agency would need to approve that. So definitely, this isn't about a board of directors sort of spending money however it wants to, but it's more about ensuring responsible use of funds and making sure that the center has a certain degree of control over how it is going to target its producers, because we're expecting the board of directors to provide comprehensive representation from the service area of the center. So these are the people who should know what kinds of services are really needed. And we're trying to make sure that those people have a certain amount of control. Now, one time when this kind of independence causes some concern is in the case of a university applicant where the center is just part of the university's, you know, many different subsidiaries or subordinate organizations. And a lot of times the university will dedicate one or more staff to the center to accomplish the work. So in the past, universities have expressed some concern about, you know, could the board of directors fire a university tenured employee? And the answer to that is no. Really what would happen is if the employee was quote unquote fired from the center by the board of directors, the employee would simply revert back to the university and whatever job they were doing before they were part of the center. And that's something that the university should make clear when it sets up its center. And it's something that the center should sort of resolve to do and approve that type of policy, because we're not trying to say that centers can fire tenured people, which is, like I said, it's been a concern. And the other kind of concern came with respect to the budget. You know, could a board of directors come in and take what was an approved budget and really make a lot of changes? And again, the answer is no, because the budget is sort of set in the grant agreement with a federal agency, which is us. And so we agree to that upfront. But there could be some minor changes. For example, you know, the budget is probably not going to be clear on how much money goes to providing organizational assistance versus financial advisory services versus process development services. You're just going to say, these are the services we're going to offer with these people. And so the board of directors could say, well, you know, initially we thought we were going to provide a lot more financial advisory services, but we see now there's not a lot of demand for that, but we see that there is an increased demand for organizational assistance. And we like to restructure the budget so that we can provide this other service. So that's definitely something that the board of directors could do. And when we're talking about kind of developing and approving a budget, that's the kind of thing that we're thinking about. We're not thinking about a board of directors overriding an approved budget with the federal government. So I hope that makes sense. And if you have any more questions or you want to run your specific situation by me, you know, certainly let me know. But I'll stop there.
Thanks, Gail. The next question, using the template, do we copy and paste things that are submitted in grants.gov? For example, the SF-424.
Okay, so no. So I'm glad you asked that question. So I just happen to have this page already pulled up, but Appendix A in the template is SF-424. And you'll see there's a little note here, electronically submitted through grants.gov. So it basically acts as a placeholder page. I thought about leaving it out, but then I thought that would cause confusion too. So if it's a form, so that'll be the SF-424 and the SF-424A. Those are both going to be submitted as separate forms through grants.gov when you submit your application. So you don't have to take a screenshot or make a PDF or anything to put it into the template. We will know that that is already part of your application and it comes as a separate attachment.
Great, thank you. Next question, can you speak more about program revenues or fees for service? What happens if we overshoot or fall short of our revenue goals?
Okay, sure. So what you're talking about is program income. Program income is, again, a complicated topic for federal awards, but essentially program income is, it occurs when you charge fees for services to the producers, and those fees exceed the cost that you needed to provide the service. So let's say that you are doing some kind of financial advisory service package, and you go in and you do an evaluation of the business, and you help them get their financial spreadsheets in order. You maybe set them up with some new software and train them how to use it, and you show them how to, you know, cost out their revenue from selling their products. So let's say you have this kind of service and you provide it for $5,000, and you have a designated staff person who, that's what they do. They provide those financial services. They're an expert in that field. And let's say it costs you $4,700 to provide the service to that producer. That's how much you pay for the salaries and wages of that person, their fringe benefits, and maybe it's their share of office rental or something like that. So you've got that cost, $4,700. That means that $300 of the fee that you charged is now program income. And so it's really important that if you plan to charge fees for services, that you work through how much you expect your actual cost for the service to be. Because simply charging a fee for service does not mean that you're going to earn program income. You still need to pay attention to it and make sure that you can show you didn't earn program income. But when you set your fee, you kind of want to think through, well, how much does it cost me to provide this? And is it worth it for me to charge a little bit more so I can have program income? So this program income can be treated in three different ways. The default method that the federal government uses is the deductive method. And that means that any program income you earn is deducted from the federal share of your award. So you got $300 in program income. Two-thirds of that will come back to the federal government under the terms of the award using the deductive method. So $200 comes back to the federal government and $100 is part of your recipient share of the project, so you keep that. And so that can be a nasty surprise at the end of your award if you weren't planning on that. And you may, depending on how much program income you earned, you may have to pay back quite a bit of the federal award. On the other hand, you did get program income. So, but it's something to be aware of. You can also use program income to substitute for your matching funds. So let's say you were going to get a third party contribution, but you realize that you'd rather provide it through your program income. So that's great. That needs to be approved by the federal agency upfront before you even start any work on your award. And it should be proposed that way in your application. Otherwise, we won't know that that's what you want to do and we won't address it with you. So if you want to use the program income as match, you can do that. The problem would be, I think based on your question, what if you earned less program income than you expected? Maybe you thought you'd provide services to 50 producers, but you only provided services to 40. And now all of a sudden you can't meet your match requirement because you didn't bring in the revenue you thought you would. So in that case, you would need to find another source of matching funds, either through your own cash reserves or through the donation of a third party. So that's something to kind of, you know, be aware of. If you can cover the cash, but you'd rather not, and you'd rather earn it through program income, matching is a great option to use for your program income. The final way that you can use program income is the additive method. And that means any program income that you get gets returned to your project. And so again, that's something that needs to be established with us upfront before we approve your award. And really the risk there is not as great. If you don't earn as much program income as you thought you would, you'll end up with a reduction in services. If it's a small amount, I don't think it would make any impact. If it was a large amount, then there may be some implications if you can't meet the approved scope of work from your grant agreement. But if it's a minor change, I don't really see that as being a problem. But the most important thing is that you decide you're going to charge fees for services upfront, and that you talk to us about what you want to do. And to the extent that you can, put it in your proposal. You know, because if you earn program income that you didn't anticipate when we approve your award, all of that program income will be subject to the deductive method, which means 2/3 of it will be paid back to the federal government. So I hope that helped answer your question. Definitely program income is a complicated topic. So if anyone has follow-up questions or you're thinking about doing that with your proposal, feel free to get in touch and we can work through the specific situation.
Great, thank you. And the next question is, I did not think this program allowed indirect costs, but Gail just mentioned NICRA or NICRAs. Mm-hmm. Are indirect costs allowed?
Yes, indirect costs are allowed. It is true there are some federal programs out there that either do not allow indirect costs to be charged, or they put a restriction of something like 8% or 10%. We do not have any restrictions. If you have a NICRA, which is a negotiated indirect cost rate agreement with the federal government, you are entitled to use that indirect cost rate. If you don't have a NICRA, you may still use an indirect cost rate, and you should definitely get in touch with us first, because that's, again, a little bit complicated. But typically, it ends up that you can charge 10% of your modified total direct costs. Modified total direct costs is something that we should talk about, but you can charge indirect costs.
Thank you. Now the next question, can you speak a little more about the restrictions if you have a current LFPP grant? And then can you use federal funds such as an LFPP grant towards the match?
Okay, so if you already have a local foods promotion program award, you should keep following the terms of that award and stick with your approved scope of work for that award and keep it separate from anything that you are thinking about doing through the Agriculture Innovation Center program. And so I admit I'm not an expert on the LFPP program for sure, but my understanding is that that program works a lot more with intermediary type organizations to market products. So you want to stay away from those types of services that you are approved to do through the LFPP program and not do them for AIC. and you cannot use any other federal grant award as matching funds for the AIC program unless that federal award specifically allows you to do that. That's pretty rare, and as far as I know, the LFPP program does not allow funds to be used as match for another federal program. So you would definitely need to keep the services between that award and your potential AIC award separate.
Thank you. And next, can you review the business planning use of funds restriction again?
Okay, so you cannot use any of the grant award funds to conduct a business plan or any kind of feasibility study, marketing plan type thing. However, you can use your matching funds to do that. So it's most important, if you want to do that, to think about how you will keep your federal funds and your matching funds sort of in separate pools for your budget and your financial planning purposes. Because if you choose to provide services that with your match that are not allowable with federal funds, you'll need to make sure that when you document your activities for us, if you get an award, that you show how you keep them separate. And so it may be that you hire a separate person to provide those services and you show that you just pay that person out of your matching funds. And it could be that you track a person's time. So let's say you have a staff member who provides allowable types of services, and then they provide these business development types of services. So you have them track their time and you show in your financial system that you can track those two activities separately. So I hope that helps clarify it. But again, you know, feel free to ask follow-up questions if you need more information.
Thank you, Gail. Next question. Can the project be extended to a 3-year?
No, the project cannot be extended beyond the 2 years. So, definitely make plans to accomplish all of your work within the 2 years. And particularly if you are starting up a center, you don't already have one up and running, or you're having to make significant organizational changes, please make sure you allow at least 6 months for that startup process. You'll need it to get your board of directors together. You'll need it to hire additional staff or train your existing staff on the services they need to provide. You'll have some work to do to kind of just get up to speed on the terms of the agreement. So I would recommend at least 6 months dedicated to the startup of your center.
And then another question, can a for-profit small business be eligible to apply?
Yes. For-profit or commercial organizations are eligible to apply for the AIC program. The big thing to be aware of if you are a for-profit organization is that you must be applying to become a center or to operate a center. And if you want that to be the only thing your business does, and you know, you can certainly change direction on that. But definitely make sure that it's clear that you're not becoming a center for your own benefit. So the centers, the grant funds cannot be used to promote your own business or operations or your own products or your own techniques or methodology. You're really setting up a center to provide services to agricultural producers. And you shouldn't have any share in the products that they develop, and definitely evaluate your processes and services for any apparent or existing conflicts of interest. And if you need help figuring that out, again, you know, follow up with me and we can try and go through your situation.
Thanks, Gail. Next question. The mini grant matching example referenced $5,000 grant, but Gail referenced a $2,500 match. I think that's maybe some worth some of the confusion regarding the 50% versus one-third.
Yep, I think so. So again, if you're doing a mini grant and you do a grant for $5,000, the total project cost is going to be $7,500. 1/3 of the, which is 2,500, unless my math is bad. Certainly if my math is bad, somebody let me know. But 2,500 of that is the match. So that's 1/3 of the project. 5,000 is the mini grant. So that's 2/3 of the project. So the matching funds for the centers carry through to the mini grants. And it's one reason why I encourage everyone to think through carefully whether you want to do the mini grants, because you can provide a service potentially for free to the producer as opposed to making them come up with $2,500 to get a grant. So it really kind of depends on how you want to structure your operation, but it's worth thinking through. And again, if you have any questions about the mini grants or how they are supposed to be offered or awarded or monitored, you know, feel free to touch base with me and I can kind of walk you through what the federal requirements are.
Thank you. And the next question is, does educational programming, example, workshops or training, count as producer services, or must a producer service involve one-on-one interaction between center personnel and a producer?
So that's a great question. Definitely the centers can provide training and workshops to groups of producers. The only thing that you need to kind of use as your benchmark for whether or not you can do that or provide that service through a workshop or training is to think about what the outcome is going to be. If the outcome is sort of targeted to helping these producers develop or market a value-added product, you should be good. If it's a general business service, say you're just saying, hey, producers out there, come on in and we want to help teach you how to learn QuickBooks. That would not be something that would be allowable because it isn't targeted at that value-added agricultural product. So I hope that makes sense. And again, if you have a follow-up question or you have a specific kind of workshop or training you'd like to offer and you're not sure, you know, definitely get in touch.
And the next question is very similar. I'll read it in the entirety, but I believe you addressed it with your answer. And that is, does the definition of technical assistance include providing knowledge and feedback within a group setting through conferences or training? And what about through educational materials that help producers navigate the process of selling value-added products?
Yeah, so definitely the group setting is fine and the educational materials are also fine as long as they are targeted toward helping that producer get from the raw commodity to marketing the value-added product. So you may provide information on food safety, like if you're looking at working with producers who are marketing food type products, or there may be state licensing or other regulatory requirements. So you might prepare educational materials to help producers with that kind of thing. So that providing services in a group or kind of an educational way is absolutely allowable. Just keep that target of value-added agricultural product in mind.
Thank you, Gail. Next question. Can the in-kind match be from state and local agencies or universities like AMS and the Ag Extensions?
Okay, so yes, the matching funds can definitely come from state or local governmental institutions. If you have a state grant, you can use that. If you have a grant from a nonprofit organization, you can use that. But do be aware, some funding coming through the Extension Service may be federal in nature. And it may not always be super clear because I think the extension can often have a hybrid source of funding. So make sure you ask. If it is federal funds, you cannot use it for match for the AIC program. If it is not federal funds, you can use it as match as long as you can use those funds for an allowable purpose within AIC. So that's something to be aware of. We have had that problem in the past where the state has awarded a grant to an applicant for doing something that's related to value-added agriculture. In some cases, it was, you know, potentially more on the applied research area, or it might have been to do a study. And the thing to remember is that all of your services need to be provided directly to agriculture producers, whether it's in a one-on-one format or in a group setting or virtual setting. you need to have that direct connection. So if you do a general industry type study, or you're doing a study to sort of say, I wonder if this kind of product made from hemp would be something that consumers would buy. So that doesn't have a direct producer connection. You're just kind of going out there and doing some research to see what if. And it could be that the answers you find, you could convey that those answers to hemp producers, but you're not working with them directly. So that's an important thing to think about if you're using grants from nonprofits or state organizations as your match. Make sure that they allow that direct service to a producer as opposed to maybe more industry level research study or something like that.
Thank you. Next question. Are agriculture machine producers eligible for this project?
No. I'm assuming that by agricultural machines, you're talking about tractors and harvesters, baling equipment and things like that. No. The agriculture producer must be actually producing the commodity. So they're going to be responsible for those day-to-day operations. They may be using the equipment like the tractors and the balers or the harvesters or the pickers or something like that, but they can't be manufacturing it.
Thank you. Next question. Any thoughts on coverage of operating costs after the two-year pilot program time period? Is the Ag Center expected to become fully self-supporting, or do you anticipate continued funding opportunities?
So that's a great question. And it's a little hard to answer, to be honest, because we have had very inconsistent funding for the program. You know, in particular, the program was dormant for 15 years. So in terms of how you think about your center's future, I would definitely encourage you to think about models that allow fees for services, or that maybe you are finding support in cash or in kind from other organizations for your future operations. You know, certainly if we have money appropriated for the program, we'll continue to run it, and existing centers will have opportunities to apply for that funding. But if the funding fluctuates from year to year, it might be that one year we could fund 6 centers, and the next year we could only fund 3, and then the next year we could fund 10, and then the next year we could fund 5. And so you could see how, depending on funding coming from the program, may be a little iffy at this point because it really hasn't stabilized. So it's hard to predict what will happen in the future. So I definitely encourage you to, you know, in fact, one of the evaluation criteria that we have for the program is targeted toward future funding and diversification of funding sources. And so that's really where you should come up with your plan to say, you know, after 2 years, if I don't get another AIC grant, can we keep the center operational to some degree through this other funding, whether it's state grant awards or private contributions or fee for service?
Thank you. Next question. Can an organization that received an AIC grant in prior years apply for another grant?
Yes. AIC centers who have received previous awards can apply in the future. The one thing to be aware of, though, is a center can't have 2 active awards. So what that means is centers who were funded through the last funding cycle are not eligible to apply for funding this year. And anybody who's funded through this cycle would not be eligible to apply for the next cycle because they would still be in their 2-year period of performance. But once that is nearing its end, then the center would be eligible to reapply for an award.
Thank you. For key personnel listed in the project, should the proposal only describe the producers who they have assisted in the past 5 years?
Yeah, I think that would be a good idea. And in fact, you only really need to show 3 years of experience. So if you can show, well, I think the way we phrased it was 3 years within the last 5, with the idea that some people may have sort of come in and out of providing that assistance. They may have a variety of skill sets. And so if you can show that they have the experience within the last 3 years, that's all you need to provide. But if you need to go back 4 or 5 years to get that 3 years of experience demonstrated, then go ahead and do that. But otherwise, you know, just provide for the last 3 years.
Thanks, Gail. Next question. Is there an existing Agriculture Innovation Center program that has done well and can be looked to as a best practice?
At this time, we don't. The centers that we selected for funding through the last cycle are just, they've been sort of going through their startup process, so they don't have a lot of outcomes to show yet. If you all want a list of the centers that we selected for funding from last year, I'm happy to provide that. Just pop me an email and I will send you the names of those centers. I can also tell you right now, it's the Franklin County Community Development Corporation in Massachusetts, the State University of New York at Cobleskill, and the Eastern Shore Entrepreneurship Center in Maryland. So those are the three centers, but they are still in their sort of startup phase, I would say. And so I think that's probably a testament to the degree of complexity of the program, as well as how long it really does take to get a center up and running if you don't have one in existence already. So that's important information. But I assume over the next year, we'll probably start getting feedback from these centers on, you know, what things have been successful. And certainly it is our intent as an agency to connect the centers that are funded in all years, so that they can learn from each other, network with each other, and move forward with each other. So definitely this is meant to be, it's meant to involve some collaboration.
Thank you. All right, next question. What are some examples of organizational assistance that are allowable? How is business development delineated from organizational assistance?
Okay, so let's go to our use of funds in the Federal Register notice. I think, Taylor, you might have to remind me because I got so excited about pulling up the notice that I didn't listen to everything you said. Could you reread the question for me?
Of course. What are some examples of organizational assistance that are allowable, and how is business development delineated from organizational assistance?
Okay. Organizational assistance. Come on back to me. I had you set up and now I got myself out of place here. So I feel like maybe I went a little too far. Let me just scooch back up here. This is good practice for all of you in navigating the Federal Register document. And it's exactly what we have to do here at the federal agency. When you ask us questions, we tend to rely pretty heavily on this document. Okay, I think we're getting close here. There we go. Okay, so use of funds, here's our section. So now we're gonna find our bullet point related to organizational assistance, which must be up towards the top of this third column here. Yep. Okay. So, organizational assistance is limited to, I'm sorry, that's outreach assistance. It was organizational assistance, right? I'm gonna get that if you keep working with me, Taylor.
Yes. Yes, organizational assistance.
All right, organizational assistance. Okay, where are you, organizational assistance? There you are. Okay, now we're good. Sorry, you guys. I guess it's been a long time on this call already. Maybe I need some more coffee. So, okay, organizational assistance includes legal and technical advisory services related to the development, expansion, or operation of a business that's owned by an ag producer that will produce a value-added product, as long as it's not for supporting a joint marketing effort. So that's the farmers markets, roadside stands, CSAs, food hubs, any kind of cooperatives, any kind of joint marketing effort, pull that out of organizational assistance. So you're really looking at working with you know, a single producer. You can work with single producers in a group, but it's, you know, it's going to be working with just the producer who wants to, you know, not do a joint marketing effort. So legal services would be like, does the producer need to form a different type of business entity? So let's say they're a sole proprietorship and they're farming and they have this idea, they'd like to take that commodity that they produce and turn it into a value-added product, and they're not sure how to do that. So the center can work with them to say, well, should this producer form an LLC? Should this producer form an LLP? And then different states, of course, have different options for business organizations. So, you know, that could be one thing I would think about. The legal assistance could also include liability agreements or waivers or assessments. You know, if you are going to be marketing a food product, does the producer need to have some kind of liability protection in case there's a foodborne illness? So that's something that I could see there. And then technical advisory services, again, I think, you know, it kind of falls into the same types of things, like how can I expand my business? So what are the steps I need to go through? So that might be, you know, again, different by states, but different states will probably have procedures if you want to change your business entity type, if you want to go into a new area. There could be regulatory or licensing impacts. There could be anything related to how that business is organized is fair game for this category. And so that's a little different from business development services that we're talking about below with the matching funds, which are we specifically define as feasibility studies, business plans, and other types of technical assistance that support business development. And I guess I kind of understand your confusion because we're using that development, but I would say that if you stay away from feasibility studies, business plans, marketing plans, that you should, the other types of services that are related to how a business forms, how it gets started, the paperwork that they need to file, the regulatory requirements that they need to meet, that's sort of the technical part of owning a business, as opposed to, you know, figuring out, am I going to market this product? Will consumers buy it? That kind of thing. And so certainly if you have any questions about the distinction or you want to go through like your particular service that you want to offer and see where it falls, you know, we can definitely talk about that. The agency is certainly feeling its way through this restriction. And definitely we're trying to come up with the best language we can to explain it. But it's new to the program and it's new to us. So definitely, if you've got a question that doesn't seem to fit this language, get in touch with us and we'll try and figure out an answer.
Thank you, Gail. The next question is, can the application support projects in three different states?
Yes, the project can support, the program can support a center that has a service area that's in more than one state. It could be three, it could be four, it could be two. The thing to remember is that the program was clearly set up for a center to serve a single state. And the reason I say that is because, you know, your board of directors is very much based on these organizations that are based in your state, in the center's state. And so if, like, I know we have had some interest in by centers in sort of common regional areas that are multi-state. So the center is going to have to be located in a particular state. Let's say it's Iowa. And then let's say this Iowa center also wants to serve Nebraska, South Dakota, and Minnesota because, you know, their expertise happens to match the producers that grow food in the or grow commodities in those areas. So the center has to set itself up based on the requirements for the state. So all those board of directors representatives will be from organizations that are in Iowa, and the membership will be based on Iowa. But that doesn't mean that the center can't provide services to producers in other states. The thing to remember is that the board of directors does have control over how the center provides its services. So this is something to think through very carefully when you approach organizations to represent, to have representatives on your board. If you really want to do a multi-state project, you need to look to the extent possible for organizations that would help support that. Otherwise, you may find that the board of directors really wants to keep the center's activities limited to a state and maybe a few surrounding counties, because their interests are going to be for the state rather than for the region. So that's just something to approach with caution. In terms of how the agency feels about it, you know, we don't have a preference one way or the other. As long as you can meet the eligibility requirements of the program and the reviewers can favorably score your application and you rank high enough to be funded, you know, whether you are located in a single state or multiple states is really not a factor for us.
Great, thanks for that clarification. The next question, does the board of directors consist solely of external persons, or can it include individuals from inside the organization?
Okay, so the requirements are for all of the seven individuals that are external to the organization. You can have additional members on the board of directors, although it's important to remember that the more people you have, that's more people that need to be involved in decision making. So the one thing to remember is that if the center is part of a parent organization, the parent organization should not have representatives on the center's board. They should be, you know, so if you have an executive director on the center, they could probably be on the board of directors, but you wouldn't expect, actually, we wouldn't allow the executive director of the parent organization to be on the board, because that removes the concept of independent governance. So definitely you can have other members on the board. I would encourage you to maybe send me an email, give me a call if you're thinking about something other than maybe like just one person from the center.
Thank you. Just a few questions left so far. When is the grant deadline?
The applications must be submitted through grants.gov by 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on September 27th. Which is a Monday. So definitely be aware of that when you're planning your submission, because a lot of customer support may be slow over the weekend preceding the application deadline.
Thank you. The next question, can industry professionals like accountants be qualified as providers of services if their experience wasn't directly related to agriculture, but the skills apply universally?
That's a good question. So I would say that, let's go look and see what the notice is instead of me just going off my head here. So we're looking at existing capability to provide services, and I'm just going to get myself a drink because my throat is getting dry. So it says, in order to be qualified, you must demonstrate 3 years during the past five providing the same type of producer services. I think you could make the argument that somebody like an accountant could provide or would be qualified to provide accountant services regardless. Certainly having an agriculture connection would be better, but I think the agency would at least consider it. We'll look at what you write up. I don't think I can give a definitive answer, but I think there would be, certainly think it would be reasonable for us to take a look at those kinds of professional services like accountants, where they're the services they provide are a little bit less specialized and more generalized. So if that's what you're thinking about doing, you can certainly get in touch with us, but it would be something we'd have to see in your application written up before we could probably give a definitive determination.
Great, thank you very much. The next question, can you explain a little more what services the program can be used for? If not able to help producers with feasibility study, marketing plan, or business plan, what main areas can the center assist with the producers?
Sure. So we're going to go to our use of funds here. So we've got financial advisory services, which I think would probably come into accountants, potentially, pricing, revenue, those kinds of things. So it could be how to use QuickBooks. It could be how to collect your costs. It could be how to pay attention to your costs and keep your receipts or track financial information. Process development services are things like engineering services, like scale up of production systems. So again, not renovating or constructing, but doing an analysis. Scale production assessments, which are studies that, studies that analyze facilities. So if your producers may be producing at a small level and they think they might want to expand and produce more, this is a place for a scale production assessment to see, can we use the existing facility that we have? Or do we have to buy a new one? If we can use the existing facility, how does that work? Do we need to buy more equipment, faster processing times, that sort of thing? You can look for cost efficiencies to see if a producer could do better at their pricing structure or things like that, or maybe do better at purchasing the inputs that they need. Systems development. So, any kind of process type analysis that helps a producer either get a greater share of the consumer dollar, make their operations more efficient, those kinds of things would work. We already talked about organizational assistance, particularly like the legal types of assistance. Outreach assistance, we might have also called this networking or making connections or matchmaking. I think those are all terms I've heard. So this is when you're looking to see, can I get producers who want to do something or market product matched up into a distribution system or a processing facility or a commercial kitchen? The centers can't do the processing and commercial kitchen stuff, but they can match producers with those types of facilities so that they can get their products either tested or marketed. So you can do some product development stuff. Really, I think you can do just about anything related to product development with the exception of recipe development, because that sort of falls into research and development, R&D, which we're restricted on. So this is working with a producer on coming up with an idea or taking an idea that they have or concept they have through the commercial marketing of it. So we're talking about concept testing, cost analysis, product taste testing, demographic and other kinds of consumer analysis, like what do consumers want in this type of product. Production analysis, where it's, maybe helping producers figure out, well, how are we going to get this product from the field to the retail market? And then also evaluation of packaging and labeling options. There may be some regulatory or licensing issues at stake there that a center could help with, or it may just be looking at consumer preferences. Do we want to see a 6-ounce cup of yogurt or a 10-ounce cup of yogurt? And then do we want to see plastic packaging or some other kind of more sustainable type packaging? So that's there. We've already talked about the costs of establishing and operating a center. You'll need some legal agreements potentially drawn up. You're going to need an accountant, clerical staff, or administrative staff. You're going to need to hire employees, monitor contracts, that kind of thing. And then we've talked about the mini grants too, where they're for the same types of services that we just talked about. So hopefully that provides some clarification.
Yes, thank you. And last question. And we're just about out of time too, so that worked out beautifully. Are territories eligible?
Okay, yes. If your organization is located in a U.S. territory or someplace like Puerto Rico, any of those U.S. territories, you are eligible to apply.
All right, and that concludes the questions. Thank you. I'll turn it to you for closing us out.
Okay, thank you so much, Taylor. I really appreciate it. Thanks to you so much, everyone, for attending today. This has been quite the marathon of information, and I appreciate your attention. And this is our first time doing something like this for the AIC program, so I hope it was valuable. I hope it answered your questions, but definitely, if you have more questions, we've got our points of contact on this slide. You can contact me. You can contact Honey Turner. We have contacts in our state offices. You're welcome. If you're already used to working with your state offices, feel free to continue doing that, and they'll get in touch with us if they need to. We have our program website. That's where we post our events. We've got our Federal Register notice there. There's a fact sheet on the program, and also, you know, the template and the checklist. So there's lots of information there if you feel like that's a more user-friendly place to get it. So thank you all very much. And I look forward to hearing from many of you after this with your follow-up questions. Don't be shy. Definitely get them out now, because the deadline seems far away right now, but it'll come up faster than you think. So I look forward to working with you as you consider putting together your applications. And I hope everyone has a great afternoon. Thank you so much.